Hi Cubies, here's your Alexandra, and welcome to another painting tutorial. Well, in a few days the new Wood Elf Army book is released, and so I thought, well, let's give it a try and paint once again a Wood Elf. So, first of all, you have to decide what kind of a Wood Elf theme you want to go. Normally the Wood Elf themes are based on the yearly seasons. For example, you have spring, summer, autumn, and maybe winter. So, well, I don't have a winter miniature to show you right now, but I will explain that right now. So, first of all, you start with the spring versions of the wood elves. Spring has a lot of very bright greens in it. Maybe an orange tone here and there, as a contrast color, maybe a little bit of red. Very nice and bright green colors. Here you can see two different versions of that. Very light brown tones. And, well, it's overall a very striking color scheme. So then we have the more summer tone. This is featured with a little bit of olive green tones, a little bit more brown tones, and more settled and darker green tones. Also with a little bit of dulled down orange at the contrast. So, and then you have the autumn wood elf armies with a lot of more brown tones, as you can see here, and my cat is playing in the background. So you can incorporate even red and orange tones even more in this color scheme if you go for an autumn theme. Well, if you go for a winter theme, then you obviously need to have grays here, like Fenrisian gray, rust gray, then maybe some blue tones. Here, Tickless blue, and obviously white tones. So this is maybe your color scheme for the winter tones. Then the leather parts you could paint in a black or in a dark brown tone, like here, Rhinox Hide. This is the palette for a winter-themed wood elf. So, what else is to say? Let's have a look at the miniature we want to paint today. Them aside, and here we have them. Well, this is a miniature I bought from eBay. I bought a whole bunch of them, and they were pre-built and pre-primed and generally in a bad shape. And that is the problem when you go for eBay. Most of the time you get quite cheap bundles of miniatures, but well, sometimes you get something on the worst part. Most of the faces are concealed with primer and in this bunch, and so I have to take them apart and maybe buy another box of wood elf archers and well, exchange the heads and reprime some parts. Well, let me explain a little bit about priming a miniature. White has the tendency to not cover in one spray. So most people make the mistake to spray too much on a miniature, and then something like that happens here. I don't know if you can see that very well on the camera, but here, for example, you have a very, very thick layer of paint, and here behind that you have no paint at all. And then if you spray too much primer at the time, it is very liquid and it runs into the recesses and into the details, like here, this details in the chest area, and it fills it up. And on top there's then not very much of the primer left. Like here, for example, here you can see that maybe a little bit, but in the recess it starts to fill up the details and ruining the miniature. So if you want to prime a miniature, always let's say this is the spray can, yes? So the distance between the miniature and the spray can should be about 30 to 50 centimeters. So maybe one half arm's length. So you're holding this miniature and the spray can should be somewhere here, if you know what I mean. And then when you spray, most people make the mistake, they hold the miniature, that's wrong. Always spray in a motion. So you start spraying outside the miniature, spray, and then release the spray button so that you never have a spot spray on the miniature. So a good thing to have is a miniature holder like that, or you place several miniatures on a tablet or something like that, and then you turn it while spraying. So very lightly, very gently, always in a spray motion, and always far enough away from the miniature, and then you can distribute the spray color in a very nice pattern over the miniature. So that being said, we will actually start painting now. So it is primed after all, so I will deal with this version now. So I will go for a spring tone in this Wood Elf army, or Wood Elf color scheme maybe. And now I start with Caliban Green as a base coat for almost the whole miniature. So just take some on the palette, a little bit of water for a better flow. And don't worry, over a white spray primer, the color is not 100% covering. You see it's a little bit cloudy, but that doesn't matter at all, because we go over it with a wash and several other layers, and in the end you won't notice it. It is quite important, if you have such a thick primer layer on the miniature, to water down the colors so that you don't obscure and cover the details even more than it is even necessary. Okay, I have talked enough for now. I will finish up base coating him in green and be right back when it is dry. Okily dokily! As you can see, our first layer of green has applied. As I said, it is a little bit cloudy, but that doesn't matter. We are just laying out the base colors right now. So we will continue with Rhinox Hide as a base for all the brown tones. Again, a little bit on the palette. Tiny bit of water, just the tip of the brush, and then start applying the brown to all the areas that need to be brown. Like the shoes, the bow, all the leather strings, the quiver. Yes, sometimes I learn even new words from you. In another video, I didn't know the name of this thingy here in the back, the quiver. Thanks for that. So, there's nothing much to say about that. Just paint the whole stuff brown. Also, the skin can be painted in brown right now. It's also a good base to start. When you go over areas with detail, for example here the fingers, then you should go several times with the brush over it to avoid having too much color in this certain area and, well, block the detail. So, like usual, I will finish that up and be right back when that is dry. So, Tewies, as you can see, all the brown parts are also painted. Yes, it looks a little bit messy, but, well, we are getting even more messy now. with some neem oil. For those of you that don't know, this is a wash or a shade. It's very liquid. And we slop it on the miniature to create all the shadow areas in the miniature and also even out the sloppy areas that we have. Fill out some white spots that we have here and there. Correct some errors. And overall, shading the miniature. That's why it's called a shade. I don't know why it's called previously a wash or a, you know, ink is a very proper word for that also. But sometimes ink have a little bit different feel to it. So, but those of you that normally watch my videos are quite familiar with this technique. So don't be shy with using the wash. Several people have the problem that they just don't use enough to create the shadow areas. And so they just have a messy spot and it doesn't look good. So, dum-dum-dum-dum. Make sure everything is covered. And then it is time to let this miniature dry. Don't make the mistake and well, let him stand upright. All the wash will run down. You will need to hold it in your hand and manually let it dry. Best way would be a hair dryer or a blow dryer or just here, hold it under a warm lamp and then simply turn it around and turn it, turn it. You don't need to do that all the time of the drying process, but the first minute or so should be done so that the great pools are not down at the feet of the miniature. Sometimes you can also well, take it upside down, shake it a little bit, so that the wash is running down all the details and knots run down to the feet. So I let that dry now and be right back when this is done. Well, 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 I guess it's time now for some serious painting. If you want to paint an army, it is always a good thing to pre-mix the colors that you're going to use. In my place here, I have pre-mixed myself a 50-50 mix out of Moot Green and Caliban Green, and then here a 2-to-1 mixture out of Moot Green and Caliban Green. So, and with that, I have a nice, consistent color chart to work with. So, at first, I will go again with a light version of Caliban Green. So, I take Caliban Green on the palette again and water it down, this time more than before. Previously this was the base coat that needed to be almost covering, and now we just need to apply another thin coat to even the odds. So also at this point you got to decide which parts of the miniature should be in the green that you're painting right now. Here, this yellowish green. And some parts I want to paint in a different green. So, for example, here, this little clothing areas that hang about here, and maybe this little triangle here will be in a different green tone. Other than that, the other parts will be in that green tone. So I will cover them lightly with this Caliban Green water mix. Also leave the dark recess areas with a wash behind so we have nice shadows. Always work in one direction. so you avoid brush marks. Okie dokie. This might take a little while. I'll be back when this coat is done. Okay, as you can see, the first coat is applied, and now we have a even coat of Caliban Green, and the shadows are nice defined. And now I will quickly touch up the other green parts with some Death World Forest. I want that to have a brighter green tone. So I will base coat those areas with this color. If you get a little bit streaky like there with the colors, also just add a little bit of water to get a better flow with your paint. Just like that. So here, and there we go. Then this little triangle thing here. And we're good to go. So, now we use the Caliban Mood Green Mix. Also watering that a little bit down. Adjusting the paint on the brush to the right amount on a paper towel. And then I will work my way downwards. With little uneven strokes. That helps to blend the colors. You see? That gives a nice blend to the whole thing. Also here, for example, I start at this point because this area here is more or less in the shadows, so I will not touch that and focus more on the outside here. Then here in these fold areas, I use the side of the brush. Here the tip. Just keep in mind that the brush has several ways to apply the color. You can use straight with a whole brush itself, for example, like here, or you could use just the tip, just the side. You can make dots like that. You can scramble it a little bit. There are several ways you can use it. And over time, you know how to handle a brush properly. This is just something that I can't really teach you. This is something that you learn over time. So be confident, paint and paint and paint. Sorry for moving the camera here. Keep on painting, and you will add experience to yourself, and over time you will be more and more confident in holding and working with your brushes. Same goes for an airbrush. So many people think that using an airbrush is, well, kind of cheating, and you're taking away lots of the artistic way of painting miniatures. No, that's actually not the case. While I prefer painting my miniatures still with a brush, I appreciate also several ways that the airbrush can do. But an airbrush is nevertheless just a tool, and like a brush, you need to be experienced. It's not though that you buy an airbrush and out of a sudden you're a reward winning painter. You also have to learn your airbrush work, so it's not cheating at all. And also with an airbrush you can't do everything. For example, detail work is absolutely impossible for an airbrush user. So even there, the airbrush user has to pick a brush and work out the details. And you see what I'm doing here? I'm picking out the higher spots of the miniature, even higher and higher, and always go in the direction where you want to have the most light areas. Okay. And that's wraps this almost. Ah, there's an area I haven't touched yet. Always turn your miniature around when you think you're done. You're actually not done at all. There are always parts of the miniature that you haven't touched yet. But also you have to remind yourself what you're painting. This here, for example, is an infantry miniature where you have supposedly to paint at least 40, for example, for the archers. Then you have to paint 20 to 30 of the Eternal Guard, and then maybe 20 dryads and a tree man. And, well, you don't want to waste your time all the way on one single miniature. So you have to cut your time here and there. Of course, some painters want to have super mega painted miniatures in the whole army, but guess what? It will take time. So yeah, in the next part I will paint up even higher highlights. Be right back. And there I'm back. Well, you might ask yourself, why does she stop recording and doesn't simply go on painting? She has the paint already pre-mixed. Well, good question. The thing is, I wanted to have the areas I painted right now to be completely dried. So right now I'm painting just one miniature. If I had a whole bunch of miniatures, for example five or ten at the time, I would make the same color paint all over all the miniatures, and when I'm done with the last miniature, the first miniature is completely dry. So why do I want to have a dry surface? Well, if you have too many layers of seemingly wet paint, your brush partially can crack the surface of the paint, and it gets brittle, and that I want to avoid. So sometimes you have to leave the miniature be for maybe half an hour and let it completely dry. So now I continue now with a 2-to-1 mix of Mood Green and Caliban Green, like promised before. Again, good water down with maybe 2 drops of water. Washing out the brush properly. Adjusting the paint amount on the brush on a paper towel. And then we start working again. A again with tiny uneven strokes. Also, if you want to be really fancy, you could possibly make a wet blend at this areas. But like I said before, this is supposed to be a miniature for a regiment, and you want to paint 40, 50, 60 of them, and you want them to be in a tabletop standard. Well, this word goes around here and there, and it is never really established what is tabletop standard. Well, I can explain that to you. There are several different levels of painting a miniature. There is maybe a poor standard, then tabletop standard, then showcase standard, and then you have competition miniatures. So, a tabletop standard is supposed to be a miniature that looks good from, well, maybe an arm's length away. That should look good on the table inside a regiment. When you take the miniature itself and hold it close to your eye, like so, for example, you can see here and there little mishaps and imperfections, and you might see the highlights here and there, but overall the miniature looks well painted, and that is supposed to be tabletop standard. Then you have the competition miniatures and the miniatures for showcasing. Those miniatures are almost perfect. You have all the fancy techniques with airbrushing, wet blending, and non-metallic metal, and all that kind of stuff that you normally would never consider even applying to a miniature on a gaming board. So, yeah, that's the difference between those. And when you're painting such miniatures, you have to keep that in mind, that you're not painting competition miniature. Some paint instructors seem to forget that, and well, I certainly have my channel here aimed at beginners and mediocre painters, and so my painting premise here is tabletop standard, or well, a little bit above tabletop standard maybe, but nevertheless, it looks good on the tabletop, and it is quite easy to follow and to paint. So, like before, I'm here painting the higher parts of the miniature. You see, we have now a nice bright yellowish green here in these areas, and we want to have him a nice, vibrant color, because he's supposed to be an spring wood elf. Spring break. Yay! Everything is awesome. Everything is cool when you're part of the team. Everything is awesome when we're living our dream. Sorry. Yes, I have watched the Lego movie lately. And this song keeps playing in my head. So, okay, this green is done. Now we head back to the different green. We started with a Death World Forest. You may remember the miniatures I've showed you before. They had a bright green. Well, this was done with the old goblin green, and then added bleached bone, or in this case screaming skull, to it. But unfortunately, I won't use goblin green here, because it is not in the painting range again, or anymore. And so I will use here the Death World Forest and try to make the best out of it. Putting some on the palette. And now I'm going to highlight it with two colors at the same time, with a little bit of yellow and a little bit of Screaming Skull. So for that purpose I have put a bigger amount of paint on the palette here. I know this is kind of over the top, but well, let's see what comes out. Let's mix those together. And we get, obviously, a brighter green. So let's test this color, if it is sufficient. And yes, we can work with that. Same technique. With a tiny little strokes. Also, a little bit of water into the color if it is not working properly for your... Oh, there we have a mistake. Wash out your brush and then, as fast as you can, try to clean that up. Well, we are here in the Caliban green area. You see, I haven't hit that exactly, but we can fix that with some Caliban green, a little bit watered down. Well, such accidents happen, and that's the way how you correct these. Just repaint the area with the closest color. There you go. Okay, going on with the highlight. Oops, sorry, that was out of focus. So, I will highlight this color even more with a little bit of Screaming Skull again. Also again, a drop of water. And I guess this is a nice tone, yes.
Yes, it is.
If you have too watery color, as you can see here, the color is pooling here a little bit, then wipe out the brush a little bit on a paper towel and rework this watery pool up and down until you're happy. With the result. Okie dokie. That's all that is to it. So, in the next part I will cover the face. Be right back. Well, Tubies, you remember at the beginning of the video I said in a few days the wood elves will be released? Well, it turns out this was a few days ago, and so right now at this point in the video the wood elves are released, and so I was not able to finish the video in time, but nevertheless I will continue now. So, where did we... left off. This is the stage right now. For me it is a few days ago, and you remember that because it was only a few seconds ago. Well, nevertheless, we will continue. Okay, Let's say we continue with the leather parts. For the boots, I think I go with Mournfang Brown and also the gloves. Also, I will not paint the hands in skin tone because I think this will fit well when this is all being painted as gloves. Or gloves, or you want to pronounce that. So, like usual, I just simply add the color and leave the recesses in the dark. Quite simple. Dum 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 dum. Dum 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 dum. Very easy to achieve. So, now the back end of the boots. So, like usual, I will finish this part and be right back. Okay, the boots and the gloves and here the shoulder parts are done. Also, I have painted the shafts of the arrows. And now we are going to highlight this. And for that, I use a skin tone. Here, Carrion Flesh Tone. Flesh Tone. Tone, not stone. Just... put a tiny amount into your brown, tiny bit of water, just the tip of the brush, and with that I'm going to highlight the leather parts slightly. We don't need to overdo that, this is just to give it a little bit more three-dimensionality. As I said before, this is supposed to be a regiment model and so super high details are not needed. So just pick a few high spots and apply the color. Also, a thing that you have to learn over time is the amount of pressure you put into your brush. For example, if you make a very, very gentle stroke like this, you can make fine, fine lines. But if you push a little bit harder, the strokes go bigger and bigger. Keep that in mind. So, now for the second highlight, even more of the flesh tone into the color. Here, the tip of the boots. A little bit here, a little bit there. And we already good to go. Okay, actually this color I can also use for the skin on the face now. Mm-hmm. Okay. Then I will highlight that with a little bit of bleach bone, aka Screaming Skull. There and a little bit there. The rest of the face is actually inside the cloak, and it's hard to see. And also, the primer has done a terrible job here in the face, so the details are rather destroyed. Well, but I do my best to bring out a little bit of that again. So I'll use now pure Screaming Skull and try to find the eye. There we go, number one. And number two. I know this looks terrible right now, but we will go to the point where it is viable. Now for a little black dot. Now comes the great equalizer, the wash. Which one? This one. Ragland Flesh Shade. Put that in and with a clean brush, we will soak off a little bit of the extra paint and yeah, we can leave it like that. I know it looks kind of terrible, but like I said, the messed up primer has deleted almost all the details that are in there, so well, but from far away it is okay. And that's all that I was aiming for. So now let's paint the rest of the brown parts. For example, the quiver. I will go now for a 50-50 mix out of XV88 and Mournfang Brown. Yeah, that's good. That's good, that's good. That I paint here the raised areas of the quiver. And that makes it look like there are two different leather versions used. Now I will highlight even more with the XV88. Little bit of water, of course. okie-dokie. So, also with that color, I will now paint the bow. And this should be completely dry when we continue. So, the next stage I will let that dry and then continue with the bow. And then we are almost done. Okay, like I said, I let that dry now, and also I will go over it with the same color a second time because it is a little bit cloudy. Well, we see us when it is dry. Okie dokie, it is time for some wood grain action here on the bow, and for that I use now Screaming Skull. Give it good shake. And now we need to mix that color with some Lamia medium. Why that, you ask? Because we want to have it nice and smooth, but still covering. So, obviously for this part you will need a brush with a good tip. So, like that. That would not be good. So, you're taking the color on the brush, good amount on the tip. And then you're testing that on the palette, if it is okay in the smoothness. If not, then you can also add a little bit of water to it. And then we will go to the bow itself. So, I want now grains from the bottom here to the top, and for that I gently stroke. The color is already dried up on the tip. That's when I talk too much and let the color stay on the brush and it dries up. So again, loading the brush, and now now it's too watery. Damn it. In German it would be called the Vorführ effect. The showing effect. Meaning that it is not working while showing. Well, the point is to make a nice streaky lines here. Also, not make them too straight. Something like that. See? That actually looks kind of decent. and try not to get this oops, sorry, out of focus. This drops of pooled color, if you get those, like here for example, loop, you will immediately go back to there and drag this drop around. Okay, then I will take some darker tone here, Rhinoxide. And making again some lines into it. Not too many. Just here and there. Well, actually, I'm not satisfied with that at all. Screw that. So, we will make a normal highlight. We will go over it with XV88 again. Shwoop. Shwoopity-woop. Shwoop-woop. So, and while it is wet, I will drag the bleached bone part here and wet blend it in a little bit. Now even more of the screaming skull. To the top. And of course the bottom. And boom, done. Okay, I will now finish up the miniature with a base, the usual suspects like white glue, a little bit sand, a wash, brown base, and I'll be back in a second. So, the base is almost done. As you can see, I've sanded it, gave it a wash in a brown tone, highlighted it with a little bit of Screaming Skull, and now we go for some decoration, and for that we use birch tree seeds. I know, this year I have gotten from Skullcrafts. This company does not exist anymore, but there are several companies that sell birch tree seeds as leaves anyway, so it shouldn't be that big of a deal to get a hold of them. So these are dyed variants. I have here some brown ones. Sorry. And I will pick some green ones also. Okay. That should be plenty. So we now want to take some white glue, apply it to the base, take the birch tree seat and place it on. Sometimes a little bit overlapping can be good. Here, for example, like that. And one over here. And final one, let's put right there. So, and ta-da, the base decoration is done. Also, you could use, of course, grass tufts or normal static grass or a little bit of moss flock, whatever you prefer to give your wood elves a nice, well, the in-the-wood feeling. Overall, I would say the miniature is kind of decent looking right now. For a regiment model, it's okay. And I hope you liked this tutorial. We see us in the next video. Your Alexandra.